nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to lecture 3.9. So we were recently talking about some applications for finite difference time domain, and now we're going to take a step back and then look at how we could actually use MEEP in more detail, right? So say we're excited about these applications, we want to do it ourselves. How is that going to work? So first of all, here's the website for MEEP available here. You can download it directly from this website, it's free software. Or you can go to the NanoHUB site and then run the NanoHUB tool as well. And so this, again, is finite difference time domain solver and has all these special features, including arbitrary dimensionality, perfectly matched layers, subpixel averaging for higher accuracy, symmetry and parallelization for faster runtimes, and then full programmability for greatest flexibility. So there are actually three interfaces that are of note. The first one actually is not as well known, but it's the C++ interface, which was the original one developed. And the idea here is that you actually have a set of member functions for MEEP, and then those are called by an ordinary C program that links to the MEEP library. And this is actually the most flexible option for using MEEP. The second option is the scheme interface. This is probably the most widely used. And so it's fairly powerful, much like the C++ interface, but doesn't require as much programming knowledge for simple problems. So simple problems are relatively easy. Of course, hard problems would require a lot more work, but should still be soluble. And it's an interpreted language, so it's actually not compiled until runtime. Okay. And then, of course, there's the third interface, which I mentioned, which is the NanoHUB graphical user interface. And so the advantage of that is it's probably easiest to start off with the NanoHUB GUI, because there are already like pre-programmed examples that you can draw from. And it's located at nanohub.org/tools/MEEP. And it reduces the complexity of your input, but also it's maybe not as flexible, but you can usually output the raw data, much like we had with S4SIM, if you need to process it further. So in order to understand MEEP, regardless of what interface you're using, it's good to understand some of the basic architectural considerations. So first of all, MEEP is based on using certain types of classes because it was originally written in C++. So it's like an object-oriented concept. So first of all, we have this class called the lattice, and the lattice basically defines the computational cell. And so this is very important because every finite difference time domain code or calculation has a certain grid, which may be something as simple as a single point, or it could be a very large 3D geometry. Okay. And then it has materials. And so there are, of course, many types of materials you can imagine, but basically, to the first approximation, we could say there are three types. One is a medium, and medium can be very complex or simple. Maybe be just like a fixed dielectric constant, or it could have some dispersion, like we were talking about earlier. Second material type would be a perfect metal, which would essentially reflect everything that comes at it. And then third is a material function, which may be some like arbitrary position-dependent superposition of ordinary media. And then there's a third class that's very important, which is geometry. So, of course, once you have the lattice and the material, that's what sets the stage to have the geometry, because you need to have this intersection of position within the lattice and also material. And, of course, there are many geometries that could be imagined, but the idea of this code is not to have a function for every possible geometry, but to have very basic geometric objects and then allow you to put those together like a block or a cylinder or a sphere or a cone. Okay, so these are very simple elements, but you can add as many as you want and superimpose them together and stuff. So, of course, if you had a very unusual geometry, it might require some creativity to figure out how to construct those from these objects, but it's usually possible. And then in terms of symmetries, we have three choices. One is like a mirror symmetry along the different planes, X, Y, or Z. Second option is like a 180-degree rotational symmetry, rotate 2, or the other one is a 90-degree rotational symmetry, rotate 4. And then another class that's very important is the perfectly matched layers that go around the system. And they have a certain thickness and direction. Of course, we said that having greater thickness creates better absorption, less back reflection. Another class that's very important is once you have the geometry all set up nicely, then you need to actually initiate the fields, and that's done through sources. And there can oftentimes be either Gaussian sources in which you use a current that has like a certain central frequency, but a Gaussian envelope of frequencies attached to it. You could also have a continuous source that will just basically oscillate at a single frequency as long as you run the simulation. And then there's also custom sources that don't follow those rules. So then another thing that you can do is create flux regions. And so flux regions basically help you monitor the output of the sources. And this goes back to what I was showing in the last few lectures about like calculating absorption and losses in different like geometric regions. And so you can basically break up like the different regions and then perform transformation of the surface integrals into volume integrals to estimate how much absorption occurs in different areas. And of course, you have to correctly set up the flux planes, and that depends on their position and orientation and weighting. So you can actually add the multiple flux planes together to get a single answer. In the next lecture, we'll talk in more detail about how to use MEEP.